Good morning, everyone. Today, we are going to learn about spectroscopy. Okay, let us see what is spectroscopy, how is it measured, various kinds of spectroscopy, and how it is very useful to us. Okay, so starting with spectroscopy. As the name indicates, spectra. Okay. So, the study of molecules based upon the spectrum that they give is called as spectroscopy. So, what spectrum is, what is the spectrum that we use? Okay. The main spectrum is the electromagnetic radiation. Okay. If we see the electromagnetic radiations, there is a range of electromagnetic radiations. So, depending upon the type of electromagnetic radiation that we are using, they are named as different spectroscopes. Okay. When we see the electromagnetic radiation, the various types of electromagnetic radiation, on the top of the scale, we have gamma waves. Then after gamma waves, the lesser energy ones are X-ray waves or X-ray radiation. Then we have UV radiation, then visible range, then IR, next microwave and radio waves. So, on the scale of this electromagnetic radiation spectrum, we have different kinds of radiation. The first one is gamma waves or gamma radiation. So as you go from gamma radiation to radio waves, what happens is the energy decreases, the frequency also decreases. As we go from gamma to radio waves, what happens? The wavelength increases, energy decreases, and frequency also decreases. So here, if we observe them, the gamma waves are highly energetic radiation. These radiations can penetrate through solid objects and are very harmful. So, these are not used. Then we have X-ray waves or X-ray radiation. This has a medical significance. We use mainly for getting X-rays of our body parts. If there is any injury, these X-rays are very helpful. Then, coming to UV visible radiation. Here, we are going to mainly use UV radiation, visible radiation, IR radiation and radio waves, okay, to determine the structure of the molecule. So, the main use of spectroscopy is for structural determination of organic molecules, mainly organic molecules. Okay, so here we have UV visible region. So, what is the range of this UV visible radiation? We have UV visible ends with 400 nanometers and UV starts around 800 nanometers. So, the range of this UV visible radiation that which is used for spectroscopy is 800 to 400 nanometers. Again, in this UV, we have two parts. One is vacuum UV and the other one is normal UV. So, for structural determination, basically we use the normal UV and visible radiation. Today, we are going to learn about IR radiation and how it is helpful for determining the structure of a molecule. Okay, and this ranges from the IR radiation is actually measured in centimeter inverse, that means the wave number. So the range of IR is said to be 400 centimeter inverse to 200 centimeter inverse. This is the range which is used for determination of the structures of organic molecules. Then we have radio waves. In this case, NR NMR spectroscopy is using radio waves. Okay, so when we have UV visible, IR and radio waves, if we see UV visible, this radiation is on the top scale out of IR, UV visible and radio waves. UV visible has the highest energy. So UV visible radiations allow electronic transitions. So under UV visible spectroscopy, what we observe? The spectrum due to electronic transition. Then we have IR. In this region, the energy is lesser than UV visible. The wavelength region has lesser energy compared to UV visible. So this IR spectroscopy will give us spectrums related to vibrational transitions. So this IR spectroscopy is also called as vibrational spectroscopy. Then we have NMR. This NMR spectroscopy uses the radio waves and they have the least energy. So this energy, the radio wave energy, is enough for nuclear spin inverse. So the reversal of nuclear spin is possible. So from that we'll get the different peaks or spectrum in NMR spectroscopy. Let us see IR spectroscopy, which is also called as vibrational spectroscopy, because vibrational transitions occur in that spectroscopy. So IR stands for infrared spectroscopy. So vibrational spectroscopy or IR spectroscope, both of them mean the same. So the main principle of this is the vibrational changes that occur within the molecule are read as spectrum, and from that spectrum will determine the structure of the molecule. So here, what kind of vibrations are there, how many vibrations occur in a molecule, and are all of them IR active? They should be able to absorb the range in the IR region. Only then we can get the spectrum. So we will see first what are the different kinds of vibrations. Okay. So here basically there are two types of vibrations. There are basically two types. One is fundamental. And the other one is non-fundamental. Non-fundamental means caused by combination of 2 to 3 types of vibrations. So first we will see the fundamental vibrations. These fundamental vibrations are again classified into 2 types. One is stretching vibration and the other one is bending vibration. So, under types of vibrations, we have 2 types, fundamental and non-fundamental. Again, under fundamental, we have stretching vibration and bending vibration. This stretching vibration is again classified into 2 types, symmetric and asymmetric. So, let us see what is stretching. And what is bending? So, here stretching means the increase in length, bond length, and the decrease in bond length is called as stretching vibration. All the molecules are made up of bonds. If the bond length increases between the molecules or decreases between the molecules, then it is called as stretching. No molecule is stable. It goes on moving. And these movements, some of these movements have stretching and bending movements. are characterizing it into a spectrum and then observing. Okay, so we'll see the types of stretching. We have symmetric stretching and asymmetric stretching. What is symmetric stretching? Let us take example of a water molecule. Water molecule is H2O. So we have oxygen at the center and two hydrogen on both sides. And is the molecule linear? No. The molecule has a bent shape. So some angle is there. And this is the bond length. So if the bond length increases, that means if the OH bond elongates. Okay. This is called as stretching vibration. So the bond length increases. Will it stay like that? No. It will not stay like that. What will happen? It will again contract. That means the bond length decreases. So what is happening here? This is the actual bond length. But it will not stay in that form. The bond length will increase and the bond length will decrease. Both of them will occur. So when they are occurring, what is happening? Both the bonds. Here if we observe, there are two OH bonds. Both the bonds are stretching, both the bonds are contracting. So if both the bonds stretch, we can represent in this manner. If both the bonds stretch together, then it is called a stretching symmetric stretching. Or if both the bonds are contracting, that means the bond length decreases, then it is called as symmetric stretching. This is symmetric stretching. This is also symmetric contracting because both the bonds are contracting together. Now, if out of the two bonds, let us say we have one bond contracts while the other bond elongates. So what is happening? One bond is contracting, the other bond is stretching. Then such type of stretching is called as asymmetric stretching. Symmetric means both the bonds will either increase the bond length or decrease the bond length. Contract and stretch. In case of asymmetric stretching, what is happening? One bond is contracting and the other bond is elongating. So this kind of stretching is called as asymmetric stretching. And when we come to the energies, stretching vibrations actually require more energy compared to bending. So stretching vibrations occur at high energy compared to bending vibrations. Again, in bending vibrations we have two types: in plane bending and out of plane bending. In case of in plane bending, what happens? The molecule is like this along the plane, the bond. Okay. Now, this is the plane which we are considering. It will move like this. Then it is in plane. If it is moving like this, then it will be out of plane. So there are two types of bends. In this case, there will not be any change in the bond length. But there will be change in the bond angle. Okay, little change. So for in-plane bending, again there are two types of in-plane bending. One is scissoring and the other one is rocking. In case of scissoring, how does the scissor move? You have the two blades of the scissors like this. They move together. They come towards each other or go away from each other. Okay. So if we take the molecule, we can represent the molecule as O, H, NH. Both the hydrogens are moving towards each other. Or they move away from each other. Both of them move away from each other. Then it is called as scissoring. Now, what is rocking? Rocking. You can take the rocking chair. scissoring, what happens? Both the bonds come together. That means the bond angle decreases. In case of, or increases, if they move away, then it is called as scissoring. If both the bonds move towards the same side, that means this is the bond, they either move in this manner or in this manner. So, if they move towards the same side, towards the front or back, then it is called as rocking. Then we will continue in the tomorrow's class.